At least one economist expects Philippine economic growth to exceed government's 2022 forecast of 6.5 to 7.5% on the back of revenge travel and spending. But he's not as optimistic about the prospects for 2023. More from Warren de Guzman.
Data from Airbnb, the leading online marketplace for connecting hosts and travelers, show domestic tourism is now expanding to new destinations across the Philippines. Guagua, Pampanga, or Halahala, Rizal were trending destinations in the second quarter of 2022, alongside some of the usual destinations like Baguio, Quezon City, and Tagaytay. Airbnb is quite excited about this, noting that aside from the evolution in destination preference, Filipinos are also staying longer, with stays of 28 days or more, up 25% from a year ago and up 90% from 2019 levels.
We are the world's largest, you know, community in terms of travelers, and having presence in over 100,000 cities, over 220 plus countries, there is a unique opportunity that we have to highlight underserved areas that have not yet received the, you know, tourism benefits on a global scale. And so we continue to make sure that we curate host stories, amazing experiences from, you know, from the country, and highlight it to our global audience.
Airbnb says as of June 2021, it has over 4 million hosts globally, with over a billion guest arrivals as of September of the same year. The company could not provide data specific to the Philippines. However, Andrew Staples, regional head of Economist Impact for Policy and Insights covering the Asia-Pacific region, is confident enough in the so-called release of pent-up demand known as revenge spending, as well as the related revenge travel, to forecast Philippine GDP growth at 7.6% for 2022.
Domestic tourism, and particularly among younger people, that I think is going to be a positive driver of growth. Pent-up domestic demand, predominantly, I think, is what's been driving the growth story in the Philippines in recent quarters. And that will continue, although, you know, as with everybody else, will start to moderate as we get towards the end of this year and into 2023.
Economist Impact expects Philippine GDP growth to moderate to just 4.1% in 2023. Its 2022 forecast is easily one of the most bullish, while its 2023 forecast is among the most bearish. Part of the reason for this is the weakening of the Philippine peso against the U.S. dollar, alongside elevated inflation. These are actually some of the reasons why other economists are less optimistic about Philippine economic growth this year. AirAsia Philippines, in fact, says the weak peso is a key problem for them. However, they hope to outgrow that problem with new routes next year.
We're still confronting problems when it comes to fuel, aviation fuel. I think that's one major concern for us. And the weakening of the peso because against the U.S. dollar. Because, as you know, most of our materials, all of our spare parts, etc., and even our payment to our lessors, are in dollars. Hopefully, we'll be able to bring bigger aircraft that will cater to our overseas Filipino workers. The Airbus A330, hopefully, would be able to have that and fly to, say, Australia or the Middle East to capture the OFW market.
Many economists have already forecast domestic consumption spending to slow because of inflation, forex volatility, and even rising borrowing costs. The tourism sector, however, is counting on Filipinos to keep traveling to local destinations where inflation might be slower compared to the cities, and the peso's weakness against the U.S. dollar doesn't matter as much. Warren de Guzman, ABS-CBN News.
Turning now to some business headlines abroad, French cement giant Lafarge slapped with a $778 million fine for making millions in payments to the Islamic State and another jihadist group to build its business in Syria. The U.S. Justice Department said the company and its Syrian subsidiary actively sought the Islamic State group's help to squeeze out competitors when the radical Islamists controlled large parts of Syria and Iraq in 2013 to 2014. Lafarge agreed to the fine and to plead guilty to one count of conspiring to provide material support to U.S.-designated foreign terrorist organizations. This is the first time a corporation has faced the charge.
Is well deserved, because in 2013 and 2014, Lafarge made a deal with the devil. Foreign terrorists who pledged to, and in fact did, harm the United States, its people, and its national security, and they did it for profit.
today's guilty pleas to terrorism charges by multinational construction conglomerate Lafarge and its Syrian subsidiary reflect corporate crime that has reached a new low and a very dark place.